TBC is GSSI, and it's a great pleasure once again to be here. Since I already told to some of you, I mean, I spent a couple of years in Aquila, and it's always a pleasure to come back. Thank you for the very nice presentations, and actually just to say a few words about my students. Actually, when I meet people in a few conferences now I go, usually they ask me, ah, but you are the tutor. Oh, yes, okay, yeah, it's true, I've been the tutor of some very good, excellent students. I just realized that now I'm already grandfather, and it's a pleasure to be grandfather of these young people. Today I would like to talk about the relationships between three notions, one familiar to basically all of us, which is the notion of proof, and the other ones, the second one, I mean, should be familiar to most computer scientists, but maybe it's also familiar to mathematicians. And the third one is also a quite popular notion in which is complexity. And then the third one is optimization. Maybe it's what I'm going to say about optimization is less familiar to some of you, but I assume that most of you have heard about approximation algorithms. I will start by an analogy that maybe it's a little bit dangerous. By the way, I will say this again, but today, I mean, you know the phrase standing on the giant of on the shoulder of the giants. Today I'm talking on the shoulder of the giants because this talk will be in many parts inspired by wonderful talks given by one of the main authors of the main results I'm going to talk about. So really I have somehow taken from these talks several ideas. I will start with the analogy that maybe it's a little bit strong and maybe some of you will not like, but I mean, after all, I think, okay, I am a computer scientist. I've been and I'm still a theoretical computer scientist, but I am also a programmer and I like a lot to program. And so I ask myself, if I am a programmer, why do you like proving theorems? I mean, after all, it seems to be something different. So if you want to be a programmer, you don't need to prove anything, basically. Well, I want to start with this analogy. Okay, this is a theorem, and you can see the proof. Okay? So I wrote it in such a way that you have the theorem in both phase, and then you have the steps the proof and some sub-steps which are used within the steps. Okay, I don't think I need to explain you this proof, it's quite easy, but I want to show you how I would write a proof of this theorem. Well, then I thought, okay, how would you write, for instance, a program to compute the solutions of a linear equation? So the title of the program is Compute Solution of Linear Equation, and then you have steps, which are very well defined, and then you have sub-steps, in which you can do several things if something happens, and so on. So they look quite similar. And indeed, if you think about it, let's think about what is the role of proofs. Okay, this is, what is the role of proofs? Okay, this is taken from a talk given by Marcus Uden. So we have the notion of reasoning. What is reasoning? According to Sudan, this is you start with a body of knowledge. Usually we start from axioms, but then when we prove theorems, we have all the knowledge that we can use. And you derive new knowledge by this body of knowledge by making use of deductions. But of course, this process is susceptible to errors, actually. I mean, it happened to me to write, not to publish so far, but to write wrong proofs. And the problem is that even one single error may propagate. So if there is an error in one proof, in one reasoning, then this error may be propagated to other reasoning that are using your results. And so you also always need a consistency checking of your reasoning. Okay? And here comes mathematics. Okay? Because mathematics allows us to capture the knowledge, the body of knowledge that we already know, the new knowledge that you want to derive, in a very precise way. And the basic tool we use to do this is proofs. And most of the time, as you will see, we switch from general mathematics to formal logic. And then we start working in the field of formal logic and writing proofs. And proofs allow us to, as much as possible, to check the consistency of our reasoning. But after all, this is not so different from what we do when we write programs. Because after all, in programming, we start with software libraries, which is the body of knowledge that we already have. At the beginning, we have basically nothing, apart from some basic axioms. And then we derive a new software by describing, writing functions. And if you are programmers, you know that we are extremely susceptible to errors. I mean, I don't know how many of you program big programs, but I mean, the probability that we make errors is very, very high. And even in this case, error propagates, because if we do an error in one small program, then this error can propagate to all the programs which are going to use our program. And usually what is the analog of consistency checking now is called the unit testing, which is testing single parts of the program in order to be sure that they are correct. Mathematics is substituted basically by programming languages. And in this case, in mathematics, usually the language is formal logic. In programming, this is not exactly true because we can use a wide variety of programming languages. But basically, let's say that they are all the same. Okay? Object-oriented, they can be functional, they can be logic, but basically, I mean, the philosophy is the same. And by using programming languages, then we can write programs, and programs allows us to realize the unit testing, which means we write small pieces of code, we test the small pieces of code, and if we are sure that they are correct, we continue in our programming activity. So I think that, after all, this analogy is one of the main reasons why, when I felt really, really felt in love with programming when I was a student at the University of Rome, and immediately I realized that it was something that I liked, at the same time I started also to like to write theorems, and indeed, most of the first years of my academic research was in theoretical computer science. Okay, so, but the relationship between proofs, mathematics, and computing is much deeper than this, let's say, little bit superficial analogy. And what I'm going to try to convince you in this talk is that you have more or less a virtuous circle between mathematics, proofs, and computing. And okay, starting from mathematics, we decide to use formal logic and to develop proofs. Then we will see that one of the main questions about proofs is how can we verify proofs? And here computing comes into the game. And as we will see, it plays a very important role. And then the results that we obtain in the field of computing can give hints to mathematicians, because it can, and I hope that this talk also will give you some idea of the limits and the possibilities that restricting our attention to computing can give to mathematicians. Okay, so let's start from the first arrow. So, formal logic. Well, I don't really think I need to say what I mean by formal logic, but I want to just review in just one slide what happened at the beginning of the previous century. Okay, I think that most of you knows what was the Hilbert program, okay, which was proposed by the German logician and mathematician Hilbert. And actually, Hilbert was very extremely optimistic at the beginning about several things. First of all mathematics can be formulated in formal logic. Okay? Second, this should be complete in the sense that every true statement, mathematical true statement, should be proved in formal logic. Moreover, it should be consistent. Of course, we cannot prove one statement and the opposite of this statement. And not only, and this is the part of the Hilbert program which maybe for us is more important, all these process of creating proofs can be done in an automatic way by a mechanical device. So the idea of Hilbert was, after all, a mathematician is just to think about interesting results. Because by using formal logic and by using mechanical devices, all the rest will be done by machine. Okay? Well, you know how the story ended. I mean, it was not like this at all. And I would like to write a novel on Hilbert, because I can imagine how was his reaction when first he had to face with the theorem of Gödel, Gödel's theorem. Actually, Gödel proved that the completeness goal was not possible. That there, in any reasonable formal logic system, there are statements which are true, but we cannot prove in the system. And not only the inconsistency theorem of Gödel says that basically the system cannot say something about itself, about the consistency of itself. So this was a really bad news for Hilbert, because the first two main points of this program started to fail. But then Hilbert said, okay, you're right, okay, there are theories in which we cannot prove some statement, but after all, if we restrict ourselves to consider only mechanical devices, maybe this is not true anymore. Maybe if we force ourselves to derive proofs by means of machines, maybe this is not true. Okay, the problem at the time, now what is a machine is almost clear. Actually, I think that we are living a period in which this notion is not so clear anymore, because we are creating a machine which simulates ourselves, and so it's not anymore clear what is exactly a machine. But at that time, really, there were no computers, and apart from the Babbage machine, basically, people didn't really know, researchers didn't really know what was a reasonable mechanical device. Because the goal of Hilbert was, okay, if we can focus our attention on some reasonable mechanical device, I mean, mechanical devices more or less can compute whatever we think it is computable, okay? But what is this mechanical device? For instance, I don't know, if you think one model of computation could be the finite state automata. Why not? It's simple, it's a mechanical device, but now you know, most of you, I think, you know that, I mean, this is not a reasonable mechanical device, because with the finite state automata you cannot do so much. So, clearly, if the mechanical device is not as powerful as it should, well, maybe you are not able to prove the Gödel theorem in this environment. But unfortunately for Hilbert, almost immediately arrived Alan Turing, and not only Alan Turing, actually. I refer to Alan Turing, but of course we are talking about Alonzo Scherz, for instance, who did basically the same things with different formalism. But I think that really the contribution of Turing is this one. He proposed a mechanical device which is extremely reasonable. And he was able to replicate the Gödel's theorem by using this mechanical device. So it was not easy at the time. Now for us it's a little bit more natural, but at the time it was not clear what was the mechanical device that we should have considered. And the big contribution of Turing was the fact that he found this mechanical device that I hope most of you already know, which is the Turing machine. Okay, the Turing machine is a very simple model of computation, where basically you have an internal state of the machine, you have an infinite tape that can be read by the machine, and you have a program which says basically, depending on what is your state and what you are reading on the tape, change your state, write something on the tape, and eventually move your position on the tape of one position. For instance, this is a machine which decides whether the number of ones on the tape is odd or even. But Turing did something more, because is this a reasonable mechanical device? Okay, we don't know what reasonable means, but now I think we know that a reasonable model of computation is a model of computation which allows to develop a universal machine. Actually, a universal machine is basically an operating system, like we know now. It's nothing more than an operating system, but at that time there was no operating system. So, the idea of Turing was, okay, I define this model and I define also a machine which is able to simulate any other machine. So, I can, during the finding, machine reach receives as input another machine and an input and simulate the machine given on the tape with input, the specified input on the tape. And this is really the origin of daily computers. And okay, of course we have to thank also all the people who were working on this field in that in these years, and especially okay the von Neumann, who formalized in a more engineering way the idea of Turing, and actually the computers like we know today are called von Neumann machine. But basically, the computers like we know right now are based on this idea. This was also the start of the computability theory. Actually, the goal of Turing was to replicate the Gödel theorem by using Turing machines. He was able to do it, and so the IPRED program was definitely killed from this point of view. But after the result of Turing, many other problems were shown to be difficult, actually impossible to solve by using this model of computation. But the Turing machine is also the basic tool in complexity theory. And usually the two measures that we refer to are the number of performed steps and the number of used cells. Okay. When did this complexity theory start? Okay, most of the people would say, okay, it started with the paper. Okay, I think that most of the people would answer it started with the paper by Cook in the 70s. Maybe there are some papers before by Edmonds in the 60s. But I don't know how many of you know that actually one of the main, first reference to complexity was done by Gödel himself. Indeed, Gödel in the 50s wrote to von Neumann. On the left you can see the German letter, and here you can see the translation of a little paragraph of this letter. Okay, let's see what Gödel is asking to von Neumann. Unfortunately, von Neumann died after a little time of this letter, so I think he could not really think about the question of Gödel. But Gödel says to von Neumann, one can obviously easily construct a Turing machine. Now, you see, they already think that the reasonable mechanical device is Turing machine, which for every formula, F, in first order predicate logic, and every natural number, N, allows one to decide if there is a proof of F, you see, proof, of length N, where the length is the number of symbols. Let psi of Fn be the number of steps the machine requires for this, and let phi of n as the maximum for all formula. This is basically the definition of complexity of an algorithm as it is taught in any undergraduate course in computer science. The question is how fast phi grows. One thing that I didn't write here is that Gödel continues saying it would be very nice if this function phi, small phi, is quadratic. So for all of you that know complexity theory, of course now we laugh. But it's clear, I say, okay, if we have a quadratic algorithm for solving satisfiability, basically, then maybe really, mathematician can rest a little bit, because we can try, actually he says exactly like this, we can try quite a sufficiently large n length of the proof, and we see if the machine is able to find a proof of our statement. So once again, if we can find a quadratic algorithm which is able to find the proof of a formula, then mathematician can stop proving theorems. They just have to think about theorems and then let the machine do the rest. Well, now we know that Gödel, we don't know if he was right or if or he was wrong, but most of the people think that he was not right. So, okay, you see, here really we have the connection between complexity and proofs. Okay, Gödel is talking basically about complexity. He doesn't use the term complexity, actually, I don't know exactly why, but he uses the term proof, and he's really creating this connection between complexity and proofs. Okay? Okay, now the complexity theory evolved a lot, and let me summarize what is the situation. Okay, actually, this is just a little part of the situation, because now we know that we have two main classes that are facing our capabilities. Okay, the first class is the class P, and the class P for polynomial stands for the set of problems for which a solution can be found in polynomial time. As I said to some of you, we are now living in a world in which polynomial is not so good anymore. I mean, even the result of Gödel, the hypothesis of Gödel, right now would not be so interesting, because quadratic time, with the explosion of data we are working with, it's not so satisfying. Anyway, so far, let's say that P is the class of problems which are easy, because they are solvable in polynomial time. An example of problem in this class is, for instance, that if we want to find the two-coloring of a map, of a graph. Okay? The two-coloring is just you assign two colors to the nodes of a graph, so that two nodes which are adjacent have different colors. Okay? There are several algorithms for solving these problems, and they are all polynomial time. But now there is another class which is now defined. I mean, originally it was not defined like this. Originally it was defined mostly by making use of the notion of non-deterministic Turing machine, but now it's much more common to define the class NP in this way. It's the set of problems for which a solution can be verified in polynomial time. Okay? I hope that you know which is here is, for instance, decide whether a graph is three-colorable instead of two-colorable. So just this little difference makes in the number of colors causes a huge difference in terms of complexity. Actually, it's easy to verify if a coloring of the node of a map is a three colors. We just have to verify locally if one node and its neighbors are colored with different colors. So this is very easy to be done in linear time, actually. Not only in the field of complexity theory, inside the class NP, some problems have been identified which are the hardest one, and these are called NP complete. Which means that if we can find a polynomial time algorithm for one problem in NP complete, then we have a polynomial time algorithm for all problems in NP complete. Okay. In terms of proof, what are we saying? What is the, in terms of proof, the existence of this class NP-complete? Well, a problem basically is NP-complete if any other problem in NP can be transformed to it, reduced, we say in computer science, to it. One problem in NP is clearly satisfiability, the problem of Gödel. Why? Because if I want to check whether a truth assignment satisfies a formula, I just have to plug in the values of the truth assignment and I can check whether the formula is satisfiable. This means that satisfiability is reducible, the problem of Gödel is reducible to all problems in NP-complete. Which means that basically now we have a lot of different but equivalent proof formats for satisfiability. You see, instead of proving that the formula is satisfiable, like Gödel is asking, maybe we it's better to prove that the graph is trigonal. Maybe it's easier. Maybe we can do it automatically in an easier way. Or instead of proving that the formula is satisfiable, maybe we can prove that there exists a traveling salesperson tour of a given length. And which means that we have really thousands of proof formats that we can use to answer to the Gödel question. In fact, the Gödel question basically reduces to a very simple and popular question: is the class P different from the class NP? Is it clear? Okay. Just a little parenthesis. Okay, in my academic life, I have proved several NP-completeness results. The one that I really prefer, and I'm not so proud of the proof, because the proof is 50 pages long, and it's a case, distinction of cases, so it's really horrible. But the problem is interesting, because the problem is the problem of protein folding. So basically it's the idea of how proteins arrange themselves in, actually we consider the 2D space, but actually the same is for 3D space. And the idea is that maybe they do it by minimizing some energy function. Why? Because we think that nature wants to be parsimonious. Well, we proved that this problem is NP-complete. Then, and this is not me that actually interpreted this result in this way, but then this means that actually, this means that nature is not parsimonious. Because if the problem is NP-complete, I mean, it takes a lot of time to find the optimal configuration of the protein. Maybe more than all the time we are on this art. So, this may suggest that when we say the nature is parsimonious, so we should optimize something, well, maybe it's not true. Maybe nature is not parsimonious, maybe it uses completely different criteria to decide what to do. Okay, so this is the first connection between computing and proofs. Okay, and it was this research field was, it is still extremely active, and I think that the peak was in the 70s, of course, but also in the 80s. But then, something happened in this relationship between proofs and computing. And okay, here, this in this framework, basically, you have your proof, which is, for instance, the truth assignment, or the coloring of the graph, or a tour of the traveling salesperson. And you read the proof, and you check that it is correct. And you read all the proof. Okay? But maybe we can change this way of checking, verify proofs. And this happened in the 80s, when two ingredients were introduced by excellent researchers. Actually, two of them are Turing Award, and I mean, it's a group of people really excellent. And they said, okay, the two ingredients are, first of all, what happens if, instead of reading the proof from the book, why I cannot convince you of the correctness of my proof by interacting? So you make question, I answer to this question, you make other question, I answer to this question. At the end, you are convinced that the proof is correct. Okay, this is the interactive protocol framework, which is basically summarized in this figure. So you have a prover, for instance, the professor, and you have a verifier, for instance, a student. And they both have a theorem. The prover wants to convince the student, the teacher wants to convince the student that the theorem is correct. Instead of giving the student the lecture notes, he said, okay, let's do an interaction. Make me a question and I will convince you about the correctness of the theorem. So what happened? The student makes a question and the teacher answers. This can go on for a while. At the end of this interaction, the verifier or the student has to say, yes, I'm convinced. No, I'm not convinced. Okay? Now, if you think about it, in this framework, nothing is really changed with respect to before. Why? Because if the student, the verifier, wants to be sure 100% of the correctness of the proof, the only thing that he can do is to ask to the teacher to explain line by line all the proof. Because even a single line can be an error. And so he has to see all the proof. So after all, in this, what we are doing here is nothing more than NP. This is exactly NP. It's not different. Because we want to be 100% sure of the correctness of the proof. But in the title of the slide, you see the word randomness. Ah, what does it mean? It means that, okay, like it often happens, actually it happens very often in conferences, no? When we accept papers, usually we say, we are confident that the proof are correct, but we are not 100% sure that they are correct. So, okay, if we introduce randomness, and if we allow the verifier to use random bits, maybe things can change. Of course, if we use random bits, if we use randomness, then we should allow the verifier to make mistakes. So the verifier can be convinced even if the theorem is false. Okay? And this is the definition of the class IP. So, what we want is that if the theorem is true, then there is a prover which convinces the verifier with probability at least 2 over 3. 2 over 3 clearly is just a number. You can put whatever you want, and by iterating the protocol, you can get any probability. So, instead, if the theorem is false, then the verifier cannot accept with probability greater than 103. Or equivalently, it has to reject with probability at least 2/3. So there is the possibility of errors, but this probability is quite small. And we can make it smaller and smaller if we repeat the protocol. I mean, the student can say, listen, I'm almost convinced, but can we start again? And so we start again, half an hour of questions, and then, yeah, now I'm more convinced, but can we start again? I mean, sooner or later. Okay, let me give you an example, and then I will show you the most popular example of this class, which I call the French example. I'm sorry that Pierre is not here, but he knows that I'm going to make a joke about the French people. Okay, I don't know if you... I think that most of you have been in Paris, in France. And you know these two supermarkets, Monoprix and Franprix. Usually, Monoprix is considered better. Franprix is... Okay, of course, French people don't go to Lidl. Never. Sure. I mean, Bobo don't go. Bobo is this class of French people, extremely bourgeois. Actually, Bobo stands for bourgeois bohémien. They don't go to Lidl. They go either to Monoprix or to Franprix, or to the little shops, which are extremely expensive, of course. So the game is the following, sooner or later I will do it. You know the French people are fanatic of cheese. No way. I mean, whatever you have eaten before, even cappuccino, then you have to finish with cheese. No way. And they have this huge variety of cheese. Okay, so the game is the following. French people are convinced that cheese at Monoprix, Comté, for instance, which is a cheese, is better than Comté, is different than Comté at Franprix. How can you do the verification? Okay, this is actually an old publicity. I don't remember the name of the guy who was testing whiskey. But basically, you can do the following. Okay, you say that they are different. No? The prover in this case wants to convince me that the cheese of Monoprix is different from the cheese of Franprix. So what do I do? I go in another place, I take randomly one piece of cheese from one of the two supermarkets. Then I gave it to the verifier, to the prover, and he has to tell me which supermarket the cheese comes from. Okay. Of course, if the two cheeses are different, he will always be able to distinguish it. But if the two cheeses are the same, the probability that he will answer correctly is just 1/2. He cannot do anything else. Is it clear? So this Monoprix Franprix version of a joke, which is called actually Coke Pepsi, because in America they talk about Coke and Pepsi. So this joke actually has been introduced in a more serious way by considering the problem of deciding whether two graphs are not isomorph. They are not isomorph. Okay? So the input, the theorem is G1 and G2 are not isomorphic. Okay? Then, the prover wants to convince me about this, and what I do? Okay, I randomly choose one of the two graphs. I randomly permute the graph, so I create an isomorphic copy of the graph that I have chosen. And then I send to the prover this copy. If the original two graphs are different, well, clearly the prover knows which one was the graph I have chosen at the beginning. Because they are not isomorphic, so I have chosen one, I've made an isomorphic copy, so it cannot be isomorphic to the other graph. Is it clear? But if the two graphs are isomorphic, then the prover has no other choice than randomly choosing one of the two graphs. And so the probability is at most 1/2. And if I want 2/3, I can do this 2 times. Is it clear? So this is a very popular example of IP protocol, which allows the verifier to check proofs by interacting with the prover. Actually, for a little bit, this was the best result known. And people thought that, indeed, IP was not such a big deal. Yeah, it is bigger than NP because graph non-isomorphic is not in NP. Yeah, it's bigger than NP, but maybe not so big. Instead, at the beginning of the 90s, actually at the end of the 80s, we had this beautiful result, which says that checking proofs by using IP is equivalent to solving problems in polynomial space. That is, IP is equal to P space. This was really a great result. Actually, it was the consequence of many results that were developed immediately after the definition of the class IP. And this result is due to Shamir. And it's very elegant. It's quite simple to see the proof because basically it's based on, and this is interesting in the context I'm trying to talk about today. Basically, they found a different, extremely different format for proofs, which was polynomials. Actually, the technique is called arithmetization of Boolean formula. Instead of working on Boolean formula, we translate Boolean formulas in polynomials. We arithmetize it. And by using properties of polynomials, we can check basically any problem in this space. Very nice result, very nice proof, and very nice interpretation, actually. I mean, it means that if we can interact, and if we accept errors, then our computational power increases a lot. We go from NP to P space. Okay? Okay, so this is the first, but immediately after, actually, I think, few months after, and I think that Shamir really thought, wow, why didn't I didn't think about it? Because his result is very famous, but the next result is even more famous, because then the idea of using randomness maybe can be applied again to the other model in which I just read the proof. I don't really interact, but I just read the proof. But this time, I can use randomness. Okay? And I accept to make mistakes. And this is the notion which is formalized in checking proofs. So, let's see. Is this proof correct? Of course, if you look at the last statement, it cannot be correct, right? Where is the error? It might be zero.
Because A minus B is zero.
Okay. 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 And in this one? No, this is a good. Actually, this is taken. These are two examples given by Sudan also. And it becomes a little bit more complicated. The square root, no? When I take the square root, I think that I'm in trouble. It's similar to the previous one, a little bit more sophisticated. I mean, it's always something that it's more difficult to explain to students at the school. No, you cannot do this. Why? I mean, it's the square on both sides. No, you cannot do it. Try. Put a positive number and a negative number. It's not the same. No? So, actually, in order to find the proof, it seems that we really have to look the entire proof step by step and looking for the error. Okay, of course, we know that the result is false, but where is the error? Okay? So, clearly, once again, if I want to do checking, if I want to check proofs without randomness, no way. I have to read all the proof. Because even a single bit in the proof, which is not correct, I mean, it can falsify everything. Think about satisfiability. If just one clause is not satisfied, the proof is wrong. And so I have to read the entire proof and check the entire proof. But if I introduce randomness, then things becomes different. And this is the PCP model, probabilistically checkable problem, proof. As you can see, we have a verifier, we have a proof, but this time, and we have the theorem, of course, the input x. This time, the verifier has also a random string, and it reads some bits of the proof, which are randomly chosen according to the random string. Okay? Now, there are two parameters here, that two main parameters, but actually there are other parameters. There are two main parameters, which are the number of random bits that I'm using, and the number of bits that I'm reading. The two functions are of n and q of n. Okay. R of n bounds the number of coin tosses that I do. The function Q of n bounds the number of bits that I did in the proof. Okay? Now, if you understand this definition, can you tell me what is the definition of NP in terms of PGP? The most easy way of defining NP in terms of PGP. Remember, NP is checking a proof deterministically in polynomial time. Everything here is polynomial time. What are the value of R and Q in the case of NP? How many random bits we use in NP? Zero. How many bits we read in the proof? All, and the proof, how long it is?
Polynomial size,
because we can check solution in polynomial time, so we cannot read more than polynomial bits. So, if R is zero and Q is polynomial, we have Yeah. Is it clear? Okay, but this doesn't help so much. Notice that, okay, we have probability 1 if the proof is the theorem is correct, and the probability 1/3 of accepting is the proof is not correct. But these are two other parameters that can be modified. Well, the astonishing result of the 90s, beginning of the 90s, was that indeed we can do this by using a logarithmic number of coin tosses and reading 3 bits of the proof. Only 3 bits. I mean, I don't know. For me, the first time I've seen it, I said, wow, what's going on here? There is a trick. Of course, we should check the proof of the PCP theorem. But okay, right now it is considered correct. And so indeed, all proofs in NP can be written in a different format. Once again, we are talking about format, because the point is this. We have mathematicians are fixed with formal logic. But when we switch to computing, we are starting to think about different formats of the proof. And in this case, they were able to find a format such that by using a logarithmic number of bits and by reading just 3 bits, you can obtain this probabilistic result. If the proof is correct, you accept. If the proof is not correct, you accept with probability at most 1/2. Okay?
Again, you can repeat the process.
If you want, you can repeat and you can reduce the probability. But of course, if you repeat, 3 bits become 6, then 9, and so on. Is this clear? So, this is a wonderful result about checking proofs. And I think it is wonderful just from a mathematical point of view. I mean, I'll give you a simple. I'll give you an application of these results in computing. But just from a mathematical point of view, I think that it is a wonderful result. And what is the application? Okay, the main application in terms of computing was the fact that by using the PCP theorem we can prove that some problems are not approximable. What does it mean? Consider the max satisfiability problem. So in this case we have a formula and we want to find an assignment that satisfies the maximum number of clauses. Okay? Of course, satisfiability is when all clauses can be satisfied, but in this case, we want to maximize the number of clauses satisfied. So what we do, remember that the PGP theorem says that any language in NP admits a proof format, which allows us to use logarithmic number or random bit and read just 3 bits. So for each random sequence, now, how many random sequences do we have? If we have log n random bit, at most how many random sequences do we have to consider? Polynomial, because it's 2 to the log n. So, for each of these sequences, we simulate the verifier for each possible answer to the 3 bits we have read. So we simulate the verifier. We have the 3 of height 3, and the black nodes are the no, reject, and the white nodes are the accept, and of course we can, this 3, which is constant in size, can be, mathematicians know this, can be represented by a Boolean formula, very easily, by some clauses. So we encode this 3 in a formula, and we concatenate all these formulas to This is the formula of Maxwell. Now, if the theorem was true, all these nodes are white because the verifier accepts always. So the formula is satisfiable and we can satisfy all its clauses. But if the formula is not satisfied, if the theorem is not true, then only a constant fraction, not exactly one half, but only a constant fraction of all the clauses can be satisfied. So, the intuitive idea here is we transform the gap in probability of acceptance of the verifier in a gap between the optimal value in one case and the optimal value in another case. This gap between the two optimal values quite immediately allow us to prove that Maxwell is not approximable within some value for that. I mean, now I'm not telling you exactly what it is. This was an open question since I think the very beginning of the complexity theory, and people fought against it for years and years and years. And starting from this, the results of inapproximability results exploded, and now we have inapproximability results everywhere. Okay. So this is to tell you that studying proof checking as consequence of computing, and like in the case of Turing, by studying the proof checking, we were able to obtain negative results, lower bounds on the power of computing. So, proof checking is something that is really deeply inside computer science. Okay, just to mention, of course, the proof is complicated. Actually, the first proof used algebraic techniques, and the intuitive idea is that the format, the proof format, is once again using this arithmetization stuff. So we switch to polynomial, and then we use these two main properties. First of all, we can check if a polynomial is identically zero. Quite easy, by making few questions to the table of the polynomial. And not only, we can also check if the degree of a polynomial is not too high, is low. The proof was extremely complicated, and I still have a colleague in Florence, Michele Loredi, who remembers that when he followed my course on theoretical computer science, I gave them his homework to study this proof. Actually, okay, you do this, you do this, you do this, and you do this. And he still remembers this. I mean, this is the legend of Crescenzi teaching theoretical computer science in Rome. The other legend was that when I taught compilers, Java was just out since 2 years, and I said, okay, let's do a compiler for Java. So they still talk about this homework for the compiler. But more recently, Irit Dinur obtained a much more combinatorial proof by using graph theory. And actually, she uses an amplification technique, basically starting from a graph. In this case, the proof format is a graph. You see how interesting it is. I mean, you can switch from one format to the other depending on what you want to obtain. In this case, the format is a graph, and then you can amplify this graph, which means that you can add. Basically, the idea is that if you create a redundancy, if there is an error in the graph, this error will duplicate, quadruplicate, and so on, and so on. Okay? So this is the basic idea. PCP theorem has a long history. Actually, I suggest you to look for this paper. It's called the History of the PCP theorem, so it's easy to look for it. And there are 35 chapters in this history, so you can imagine how many results were obtained in this proof-checking history. And the last proof is by Erich Dinur, and the PCP theorem actually appeared in this paper. You don't see it. Aurora Lund, Motuani, Sudan, Zegedi, and Madhu Sudan is one of the authors. And as I told you at the beginning, today I'm talking on the shoulder of Madhu because I was really inspired by his talk and what I'm saying today. So if you have Ranjit Motuani, who unfortunately passed away several years ago, and great research. And just to conclude, I think it's right. And just to conclude, okay, actually you don't see it very well, but in the left part of this science, actually it's the the science magazine of the New York Times, they wrote about the PCP theorem. And now it's not easy to read the title, but it says new shortcut found for long math proofs. Okay, so clearly this was publicity. Because if you read this title, it means maybe, starting from now, we should write our proofs in the format suggested by the PCP theorem. Okay, first of all, I don't suggest you to do this because it's almost impossible. But okay, maybe you can do it, you can make it by machine, no? And by a program. But it's not so true because we know that, first of all, proofs are quite never self-contained. So we always refer to all the proofs and blah, 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 that should be written in the PCP format. And moreover, they very often rely on common context. I mean, you know, the proof by intimidation. It is clear that. Or it is easy to show this. Okay, this is something that we have to explicit if we want to use the PCP. So, I mean, this is the article of New York Times was basically publicity. But Sudan himself suggested maybe, the PCP format can be useful in the field of computer-assisted proofs. Because in this case, I mean, it's a computer itself which is producing the proof. So, we can ask him to be complete, self-contained, blah, 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 and to write the formula in the PCP format. So maybe it can be, I don't know, but it can happen. And anyway, the PCP and the check proof, the proof checking stuff, it has been and it is still a very active research area, very active. There are several parameters you can play with, the number of random bits, the number of query bits, the probability of acceptance in one case, the probability of acceptance in the other case, and there are other parameters that have been introduced. And all these parameters have some consequences in the computing field. So, but not only, really last year, at the Fox conference 2017, a paper was published in which they developed a new version of the PCP theorem, which allows to show lower bounds for cubic solvable problems. So for all of you that are following the course on Latvia mining, you know that cubic is too much. We want to know if we can solve some problem less than cubic or less than, quadratic, less than quadratic. And this paper they prove a new version of the PCP theorem, which is called distributed PCP theorem. And by using this distributed PCP theorem, they can show lower bound for the approximability, but in the range of polynomial problems, which is really significant because polynomial now, it's not really equivalent to efficient. Okay, of course, the main question is still open. I mean, having found a different format for proofs doesn't solve the main open question. And of course, this is still open. I mean, there are some mathematicians who say that, yeah, but this is, I mean, this is easy stuff. I mean, why are you losing time on this? Should be. This is one of the six problems for which there is a Clay Institute award. And it is considered like the easiest one. Actually, it was observed that if you solve this one, you can solve, for instance, if you prove that P is equal to P, then you have solved also the other one, because you can produce in polynomial time the proof of the other ones. Okay, so if you prove that P is equal to P, you don't win 1 million, you win 6 million, because there are six problems. And I want just to conclude with a joke, because at lunch we talk with Luke about this. I mean, the message is, what we do in computing is really science, in the very deep sense of science. We really go to the essence science, which is proof checking, and it's not being science, like maybe somebody can think. And okay, I hope that you enjoyed this short introduction to this history of proof checking and computing.
Intellectual journey through the history of proofs and proof checking and the importance of computer science in all this. We may have time for questions if anyone has any.
Do you know the book Good and Lesser Fact about computers? Have you been inspired?
Okay, yeah, the question is if I read the book Get a Lecture and Back by Hofstadter, and if I was inspired by this book. Sincerely, the answer, okay, the answer to the first question is yes, of course. I mean, I don't know, I think especially in my generation, it was not possible not to read the book by Hofstadter. And I loved it when I read it several years ago. No, I was not inspired by it right now, because for me it was mostly related to, I don't know, I still have, I read it many, many years ago, and I still connect it more to the other very interesting question, but more related to artificial intelligence. Indeed, I was almost tempted to say, okay, I don't know exactly what's going on now and what will happen with the programs that we actually didn't write, because we wrote the program to train the neural network, but we didn't write the neural network. So I don't know exactly what happens from this point of view, but the answer is no. Why did you say so?
Because there are connections about grammars, languages, and checking computing.
Ah, okay, okay.
Only the first part of the book, the rest is yes.
Yeah, okay.
About,
I agree. Okay. Okay, I agree. The, if fail because the first part of the book has no connection on this. Actually, yeah, you're right. For me, the second part is the one which contains the main message of the book. Actually, Stutter, as far as I understood, does not agree anymore with what he wrote in this book. And so I didn't think about it, but I think you're right. Yeah. And the first part, I think you're right. Yeah.
Any more questions from the audience?
About the comparison between mathematics and programs or programming languages in the first slide, I think that is, I mean, the main difference, of course, is that programming languages often don't have a really well-defined semantics as opposed to mathematics. And I mean, do you have any insight on whether this could help closing this gap? I mean, having a more formalized set of languages and tools. So.
Yeah. Okay, the question was in the first slide I made this analogy. I mean, I think it was a sort of provocation, of course. I'm not really convinced of this analogy, but I liked it to show it to you. And one thing, first of all, I want to say is that, as you can see, the proof is not written in formal logic. Is written in natural language, so the problem of semantics, of ambiguity and so on, is present in both contexts. And this is true. Well, I don't know if... maybe Luca can answer better.
Yeah,
than
but
me
actually, if I may, on this point,
that's why
your start was not a provocation at all, as far as I'm concerned, because if you look at it from the perspective of a programming languages person, especially if you're doing functional programming language, there is something which is called the Curry-Howard isomorphism, which is essentially predicated on this motto, which turns out to be justified also by formal results. And Jean-Yves Girard and several other French people, amongst others, apart from Curry and Howard, worked on this. Proofs are actually programs and propositions that you're proving are types in programming languages. And there is a beautiful correspondence between proofs and programs and propositions and types in the simple type lambda calculus and other basic programming languages. So rather than being a provocation, this is actually a fact of programming life.
Very good. So I hope it answered to you. I was sure that Luca was better than me in answering this question. Thank you, Luca. I will call you every time
I
want to talk about this. I will call you.
So.
Yeah.
Okay, perhaps I have one final question and then we can all leave or take further questions offline. So you have this result that you mentioned was one of your favorite anti-completeness results that you have proved about the complexity of protein folding.
Yeah.
And then you said, well, perhaps this result tells us that nature is not parsimonious. But couldn't you read it also as perhaps the nature doesn't do the proteins that you use in the hardness group, which I'm sure are pretty simple, are being synthesized by you for hardness results.
Yeah.
So are these proteins that you actually show are hard to fold real proteins or synthesized proteins?
Okay, so the question of Luca was concerning the MP completeness of protein folding problem, and it's true that when you prove that a problem is MP complete, you create very specific instances of the problem. Okay, and so the question of Luca is maybe it's not the fact that the nature is not parsimonious, but that the instances with which the nature has to deal with are different from the difficult core that you have proved to be a p-complete. I agree, but it's not so exciting saying, so it's more exciting saying that the nature is not
I
completely agree. I completely agree. It might be that indeed the instances that nature has to solve are much, much easier than, and sincerely, after the paper we wrote, I didn't continue to study a problem, so I don't know if maybe they started to consider some special cases that were solved. Yeah, you're right.
Okay, I suggest that we take further questions offline, and we thank Pierluigi for a wonderfully entertaining and informative talk.